As for these celebrated victories of science, there is no doubt that they are victories. But victories over what? This is the deepest and sharpest infrared image of the distant universe created so far. It was photographed by NASA's James Webb Space Telescope. These images have a way of capturing our imagination. They show us the vastness of the universe, and for some, they serve as a reminder of our insignificance in the grand scheme of things. This feeling of insignificance when faced with the literal vastness of the universe is perhaps best expressed by Carl Sagan's famous Pale Blue Dot speech. It's actually a narration from a book by the same name, and here's an excerpt that captures the gist. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that, in glory and triumph, they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that you have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. This sentiment was found everywhere on social media in the days following the publication of the web image of the universe. We are invited to think of ourselves and of our fellow humans and of humanity itself as small, alone, and even meaningless. What meaning could there be found in a universe that is so cold, uncaring, and inhospitable? A universe on which we, mere humans, occupy less than a fraction of a grain of sand. Just some sentient bags of water and carbon on a rock floating through space. The discourse on social media reminded me of a passage in Nietzsche's Genealogy of Morals. In the third essay of that book, Nietzsche continually asks the reader the same question over and over again. What is the meaning of ascetic ideals? Nietzsche diagnosed a current of so-called ascetic ideals through four areas of human culture: religion, philosophy, art, and science. While Nietzsche was not formally trained in science, we know he did keep an active interest in the scientific developments of his day. If you want to brush up on your scientific knowledge, you can check out Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. Brilliant is an interactive learning platform that offers hands-on lessons in math, science, and computer science. They have an interactive teaching method that focuses on solving problems instead of just memorizing stuff. I enjoyed going through their two logic courses to refresh my knowledge of this discipline that's the backbone of philosophy. They also offer a course on scientific thinking. A good foundation in these disciplines always comes in handy. If you're a self-taught philosophy enthusiast, don't neglect this part of your education. Kant was well-versed in mathematics, Schopenhauer studied medicine, and Nietzsche was interested in biology. Brilliant takes you step-by-step through the entire learning process in a fun, interactive way. They focus on visualizations and interactivity, which really improves how well you can grasp the concepts they discuss. Join the millions of people already learning on Brilliant with a special offer just for viewers of the channel. Head to brilliant.org/Weltgeist to get started for free with Brilliant's interactive lessons. The first 200 viewers will also get 20% off an annual membership. Thank you to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Back to the Genealogy of Morals. Nietzsche continually and repeatedly asks the same question. What is the meaning of ascetic ideals? He will find these ideals expressed in four domains: religion, philosophy, art, and science. Now, this final third of the genealogy is ingeniously constructed so as to not reveal the answer to the question, what is the meaning of ascetic ideals, until the very last sentence of the entire book. All the way throughout, Nietzsche is building up tension, tackling idols and representatives in religion, philosophy, art, and science to slowly make his case and expose the different instantiations of these mysterious ascetic ideals, until in the final paragraph of the book he ties everything together and reveals the answer to us. The most obvious instances of these ascetic ideals are found in religion. Indeed, one could argue, and Nietzsche basically does argue, that the entire point of religion is to foster an ascetic ideal in man. But what is an ascetic ideal? Religion gives us the most straightforward answer. An ascetic ideal, generally, is that ideal which promotes a movement away from the material world, away from the here and now. Religions, in Nietzsche's view at least, tend to show a general distrust of the material. In the case of Christianity, the material world comes second to the immaterial world, heaven or the kingdom of God. In the case of Hinduism and Buddhism, the material world is exposed as illusory or the cause of all suffering. This general distrust of the material is then expressed in specific commandments, almost all of which are geared towards a denial of the material. Almost every religion promotes these ascetic practices. They include fasting, abstinence, prayer or meditation, glorification of poverty, and in some cases even self-flagellation. What they all have in common is that they deny some aspect of the material world, be it food and drink, or the sustenance of life, be it sex, or the creation of life, or be it a withdrawal from the world and flight into the mind in the case of prayer or meditation, and also willful destruction of the material body through self-flagellation. And willful poverty, of course, is all about having no material possessions and also not desiring any possessions. This is the ascetic ideal as it presents itself in religion. In philosophy, Nietzsche finds traces of this ascetic ideal starting with the Socratic revolution all the way up to Schopenhauer. So in other words, he finds traces of the ascetic ideal throughout the entire Western philosophical tradition. In art, he finds the ascetic ideal most pronounced in the late operas of Richard Wagner, chiefly in his final work Parsifal. But what about science? Well, spoilers ahead, Nietzsche will attack science, or rather modern science, and accuse it of being another instantiation of this ascetic ideal. But in order to understand this attack, we need to dig a level deeper. The ascetic ideal is a principle by which movement away from the material world is encouraged. We saw the examples of fasting, abstinence, prayer, poverty, and self-flagellation in religions. But this movement is not just a withdrawal from the material world. It's also a turn away from our material body, which is, after all, part of the material world. With the exception of poverty, which is directed outwards, most of these ascetic practices are actually directed inwards, focusing on the inner life and our physical body. The ascetic practices of these religions are not only about the external material world, but in a very literal sense, they are about withdrawing from yourself by attacking the material vessel with which you exist in the world, that is to say, your body. But the thing is, unless you believe in the soul or the spirit, your body is more or less synonymous with yourself. What is the meaning of ascetic ideals? For Nietzsche, the ascetic ideals are not simply about hatred or contempt for the material world, but also about contempt for the self. Because the cruel fact of the matter is that the ascetic actually derives pleasure from his suffering. These ascetic feats that require so much willpower, even though they lead to a general state of weakness, are a source of pleasure, or to put it in more Nietzschean terms, a source of power. Nietzsche's grand thesis is that there is pleasure in contempt, pleasure in weakness, pleasure in being hungry, denying yourself food and drink, even pleasure in hurting yourself. This is the paradox that lies at the heart of the ascetic, who outwardly claims to chase neither power nor pleasure, but in fact claims to chase the exact opposite. He has to derive pleasure from his hard lifestyle, because as an ascetic, it's the only pleasure he is afforded. His will has nowhere else to go. He has no other way to vent his very human desire for power. The will to asceticism is thus exposed as just another form of will to power. A sense of pleasure is experienced and sought in abortion, in decay, in pain, in misfortune, in ugliness, in voluntary punishment, in the exercising, flagellation, and sacrifice of the self. All this is in the highest degree paradoxical. We are here confronted with a rift that wills itself to be a rift, which enjoys itself in this very suffering, and becomes more and more certain of itself, more and more triumphant, in proportion as its own presupposition, physiological vitality, decreases. This is also why, as much as Nietzsche holds Christian morality in contempt, he can't help but have respect for the Christian saints, these exemplars of asceticism and therefore exemplars of will to power. What is the meaning of ascetic ideals? In this analysis, the ascetic ideals are exposed as not just a flight from the material world, but as contempt for the body and therefore contempt for the self. Worse yet, the ascetic ideal exhibits a pleasure in this contempt for the self. In modern parlance, we might paraphrase Nietzsche as saying that it feels good to hate yourself. Because hatred gives you a feeling of power. Every complaint and every curse, offers a little taste of power. The ascetic ideal, in other words, is not just about hating the world. It's also about hating yourself. And it will find reasons everywhere to do so, simply because it's pleasurable. This is where this image comes in. Every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. What would Nietzsche think of this pale blue dot speech? If you go by what he wrote in the Genealogy of Morals, he would see evidence of the ascetic ideal in this insistence of science, and astronomy in particular, that humans, that is to say, we ourselves, are insignificant and meaningless. You would think that this admission and discovery of our insignificance would be cause for great concern, panic, or even grief. But the news of this discovery of our meaninglessness, as it is presented in speeches such as the pale blue dot one, or the reaction of social media to the James Webb telescope image, indicates otherwise. Astronomy tells us we are nothing, a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. Should we not be horrified at this prospect? Yet exactly this meaninglessness, precisely this insignificance, is what Carl Sagan turns into meaning and significance. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known. Astronomy is both humbling and character-building. It demonstrates the folly of human conceit, yet it should also uplift us ethically, encourage us to be compassionate and kind. The problem here is obvious. Nietzsche would rhetorically ask Carl Sagan, if everything is so meaningless in this vast, uncaring cosmos, why bother being kind at all? Where do your ethics come from? Certainly not from the cold, hostile universe. And what a particular kind of ethics it is. Being more kind to one another. This might just as well have been said by Jesus or Schopenhauer. But unlike Jesus and Schopenhauer, the atheistic science-based cosmology does not allow for transcendental origins of morality such as God or a Schopenhauerian will. By the way, whether or not Carl Sagan was himself an atheist or not is not the point here. We're interested in the general sentiment expressed in the pale blue dot speech. As far as I can tell, Carl Sagan considered himself agnostic. Just like Nietzsche, we are dealing here with the archetype of the scientist, the same archetype discussed by Nietzsche in the Genealogy. The archetype of the scientist as the atheistic materialist. The pale blue dot speech simply epitomizes this worldview and this archetype, which is why we're using it in this video. Nietzsche would have many problems with this speech, not in the least with the incitement to what he would call herd ethics of being kind to one another. It echoes the critique he had of many atheistic moralists. They are rid of the Christian God and therefore think it all the more incumbent upon them to hold tight to Christian morality. Christian morality is a command. Its origin is transcendental. It is true only on condition that God is truth. It stands or falls with the belief in God. As for us, we act differently. When we renounce the Christian faith, we abandon all right to Christian morality. Now, the ethics are not really the root of the issue here. It's one of the problems Nietzsche would have with the pale blue dot speech. The main problem he'd have concerns the state of modern science as a whole, and it's exemplified again in that pale blue dot speech, where Sagan echoes the idea that humans are nothing in the grand scheme of things, just specks of dust in a vast, uncaring cosmos. In this idea, Nietzsche would find nothing more than yet another instance of the ascetic ideal, the pleasure of putting ourselves down. In fact, he frankly accuses scientists of deriving a perverse kind of pleasure from this self-belittling. All science, and by no means only astronomy, with regard to the humiliating and deteriorating effect of which Kant has made a remarkable confession, it annihilates my own importance, nowadays sets out to talk man out of his present opinion of himself, as though that opinion had been nothing but a bizarre piece of conceit. You might go so far as to say that science finds its peculiar pride, its peculiar bitter form of stoical ataraxia, in preserving man's contempt of himself. According to Nietzsche, ever since the days of Copernicus, who showed that man lies not at the center of the universe, science has been on a steady path to destroy our self-image, our self-perceived importance in the cosmos, and therefore any meaning we might attach to that importance. Copernicus taught us that we are not at the center of the universe. Then, Darwin showed us that we are not even special creatures, created in the image of a god. Darwin showed us that humans are simply intelligent apes, in other words, ordinary animals. Little by little, these scientific discoveries chip away at our privileged position in the cosmos. Of course, Nietzsche doesn't deny the truth of these discoveries. He acknowledges that they are scientific victories, but let's revisit the quote at the start of the video. As for these celebrated victories of science, there is no doubt that they are victories. But victories over what? There was not for a single minute any victory among their lists over the ascetic ideal. Rather, it was made stronger, that is to say, more elusive, more abstract, more insidious. The ascetic ideal is alive and well, even as its traditional outlet in the form of religion and theological pre-Copernican astronomy and theological pre-Darwinian biology have ceased to be taken seriously. The victories of science have done nothing to alleviate humanity's sickness, its will to self-belittling. In fact, it's only become stronger because it's more abstract, more hidden, and less obvious. The ascetic ideal now has the veneer of scientific truth and objectivity. We are moving away from religion and towards science. But, and this is Nietzsche's ultimate claim, psychologically, it makes no difference at all where we are going. What underpins both old religion and modern science is the same. It's the ascetic ideal in a different form. Alas, his belief in his dignity, his uniqueness, irreplaceableness in the scheme of existence, is gone. He has become animal, literal, unqualified and unmitigated animal. He, who in his earlier belief was almost God. Since Copernicus, man seems to have fallen onto a steep plane. He rolls faster and faster away from the center. Whither? Into nothingness? Into the thrilling sensation of his own nothingness. Well, this would be the straight way to the old ideal. But what is Nietzsche's problem with all of this? Ultimately, nothing. That is to say, he unearths in this modern brand of science the same nihilistic tendency he found in religion and pessimistic philosophy and romantic art. He found man reduced to nothing, a worthless creature. But at least in religion, man could be saved. In the cold, uncaring cosmology of modern science, no redemption at all is possible. Modern science is exposed by Nietzsche as simply another style of nihilism, rebranded nihilism, we could say. Except it has become even more insidious than in the past, offering no hope or redemption. Nietzsche accuses Christianity of being nihilistic, but that's only if you stop believing in God. To the honest, pious Christian, the universe is imbued with meaning. Nietzsche's famous dictum, "God is dead," addressed the disappearance of this sincere Christianity and the calamity of nihilism that would result. Modern science only digs us deeper into that black hole of nihilism. Just like a literal black hole, it swallows everything and gives us nothing. But if these scientific discoveries are true, then what can we do about it? What if nihilism is the truth? Well, let's go back to the pale blue dot speech again and look at the morality presented there. To me, this image underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another. Nietzsche asks, why is this the case? Where does this conclusion come from? Just because our planet is but a grain of sand in the grand sea of the universe, it does not follow that we should be kind to each other. The conclusion does not strictly follow from the premise. Rather, Nietzsche would argue that Carl Sagan's morality is something presupposed. Carl Sagan probably believed a priori that we should be kind to each other, and he used this image of the world to justify that belief. But where did that belief come from? Well, from the same ascetic ideal. Carl Sagan may not be a Christian, but his morality sounds very Christian indeed. I'll quote a passage from Twilight of the Idols in which Nietzsche discusses godless yet Christian morality in the context of the English utilitarians. But what he's saying holds true just as well without that context. If the English really believe that they know intuitively and of their own accord what is good and evil, if, therefore, they assert that they no longer need Christianity as a guarantee of morality, this is in itself simply the outcome of the dominion of Christian valuations and a proof of the strength and profundity of this dominion. It only shows that the origin of English morality has been forgotten, and that its exceedingly relative right to exist is no longer felt. For Englishmen, morality is not yet a problem. Carl Sagan's incitement to neighborly love, the most Christian value of all, simply shows that the origin of his morality has been forgotten. For science, Nietzsche might quip, morality is not yet a problem. Nietzsche's philosophical project is all about the unmasking of these prejudices, the tearing down of idols, both religious and philosophical, and scientific in nature. Nietzsche wants us to overcome this ascetic ideal, to break free from our holding fast to Christian morality. Above all, he wants us to regain our dignity as humans, to not view ourselves as weak, insignificant animals. In other words, he wants to overcome nihilism. But the answer to this question, how will we overcome nihilism, will not come from science. Modern science is a project of enforcing nihilism, just like religion once was. And Nietzsche saw the ultimate proof of this in the perverse pleasure people seem to derive from fawning over images like this and relishing in their own unimportance, never tiring of pointing out how small we are, how inconsequential our existence is, how useless our pride, how empty our life. The thrilling sensation of his own nothingness. Nietzsche's philosophical project is all about putting mankind back at the center of the universe. And if that's not possible in a physical, scientific sense, as shown by recent developments in science, then at least in a moral sense. In other words, Nietzsche wants us to love ourselves again, and to love our lives again. We are not insignificant. If the universe is meaningless, which it very well might be, then at least we humans can create meaning. Man is something that is to be surpassed. What have you done to surpass man? All beings hitherto have created something beyond themselves. And you want to be the ebb of that great tide, and would rather go back to the beasts than surpass man? Thank you for watching. If you found this video valuable, please like and subscribe, and leave a comment for the algorithm if you're so inclined. This video might be a bit controversial, so let me reiterate that I don't want to attack Carl Sagan personally, but the pale blue dot speech is simply a nice expression of a general sentiment that's found all over the internet whenever scientific discoveries or accomplishments are publicized. The recent images of space reminded me of this passage in Nietzsche, and I found it worthwhile to explore this topic and provide a bit of countercurrent to the usual discourse. Speaking of discourse and social media, we're also on Twitter, and we're trying to be more active there in the future. So if you want, please give us a follow. Thank you also to our Patreons who support the channel and keep us going with their generous support. You can join by clicking the link in the description, if you want to support the channel, that is. Patreons in the higher tiers also get access to an exclusive Patreon-only video every single month. This video drew heavily on the genealogy of morals. We've done an in-depth analysis of this work that's 1 hour long, and personally I think it's the best video on the channel. Check it out if you're interested, and if you want to learn more about the ascetic ideal, where it comes from, and where it will lead. We've also covered The Joyful Science recently, in which we explored Nietzsche's concept of the death of God in more detail. The video has been well received, and we recommend checking it out if you haven't already. Again, thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.